Okay, the next item of business is a statement by the Right Honourable Dorothy Bain KC on Horizon Information Technology Prosecutions. The Lord Advocate will take questions on the issues at the end of her statement, therefore there should be no interventions or interruptions. And I invite the Lord Advocate around 10 minutes, please.
Thank you. Presiding Officer, I welcome this opportunity to address Parliament today to provide an update on the steps taken by those working within the criminal justice system to address prosecutions in Scotland involving evidence from the Post Office Horizon IT system. In my previous statement, I confirmed that I and the Crown Office and the Procurator Fiscal Service are committed to addressing all miscarriages of justice. I made it clear to that end, work has been underway in Scotland to address this issue since 2020. This has included collaborating with the Scottish Criminal Case Review Commission to assist in identifying and referring impacted Scottish cases before the High Court of Justiciary for review. Notwithstanding the practical challenges that have been faced in identifying and assessing the potentially impacted cases due to the passage of time and limited records available, I understand that the Scottish Criminal Case Review Commission has made efforts to write to all individuals in Scotland who it's considered may have been affected by these issues and have invited them to apply for review of their case. I am pleased that individuals have come forward. At present, 6 cases have been quashed by the Appeal Court, 2 appeals are currently before the Court, and 10 cases are being reviewed by the Commission. On 30 April 2024, Scotland's Appeal Court issued an opinion regarding the now concluded cases. This judgment endorsed the approach taken both by the Commission and the Crown in assessing the different circumstances in which Horizon evidence played a role in the original cases and in concluding that these appeals should succeed. In my previous statement, I also made it clear that as Lord Advocate, I could only seek to address miscarriages of justice within the legal framework that is available to me, and for this reason, despite what some have wrongly suggested, it is not possible for me to achieve mass exoneration of all those who have been impacted. I wish to make it clear that this was not a comment on whether I supported the concept of mass exoneration. As Lord Advocate, I have responsibility to protect the administration of justice in Scotland and uphold the rule of law. I can only use the tools which are available to me, as I have done to date. As you will recall, I committed to reviewing the Post Office's continuing status as a specialist reporting agency. I can confirm that because of its fundamental and sustained failures in connection with Horizon cases in Scotland, I have decided that Post Office Limited is not fit to be a specialist reporting agency. It is therefore no longer able to investigate and report criminal allegations directly to the Crown, and it should now instead report any allegations of criminality to Police Scotland for them to investigate. I can also advise that work is ongoing to strengthen the guidance and safeguards that exist to ensure that all Scotland's specialist reporting agencies abide by the essential duties of disclosure and candour in reporting cases for prosecution. On Tuesday of this week, the Scottish Government introduced the Post Office Horizon System Offences Scotland Bill. As the principal legal adviser to the Scottish Government, I advise the Government on the legislative competence of any bills that it seeks to introduce. I exercise my legal adviser functions objectively and independently. While ministers share collective responsibility, the Cabinet Secretary for Justice and Home Affairs has ministerial responsibility for this legislation, and it will be for her to set out the Scottish Government position. I now wish to address questions which have been posed in recent weeks regarding the actions taken by the Crown in response to concerns about the integrity of the Horizon system in 2013. As I previously explained, at no time did Post Office disclose to the Crown the true nature and the extent of the issues with its Horizon system. Reference has been made in this chamber to the findings of the interim report by the independent accountancy firm Second Sight, which was published in July 2013. Second Sight identified two instances where defects or bugs in the Horizon online system had affected 76 branches across the UK, but they concluded that there was no evidence of system-wide problems within Horizon software. These findings were endorsed in the House of Commons by the relevant minister shortly after the report's publication. Crown Office officials were given assurances by Post Office that these isolated bugs did not affect the small number of potentially impacted cases that had been reported to the Crown. It was also explained that these cases had been reviewed by the Post Office in light of the report, with no concerns raised. Notwithstanding the assurances provided by Post Office, Crown Office officials, noting that the report recommended further interrogation of the system, requested that the Post Office obtain further expert evidence to support the integrity of the system. As I've previously explained, while this was awaited, Scottish prosecutors were expected to carefully consider any Post Office case on its specific facts and circumstances. Where concerns regarding Horizon arose, prosecutors were advised to suspend prosecutions to await the further expert evidence. In 2015, due to the Post Office's failure to provide further evidence to support the system, cases that relied on evidence from the Horizon system were to be discontinued. The Crown is reviewing its records to identify the cases that may have been affected by these failures in disclosure by the Post Office. Four cases have been identified that were prosecuted after the meeting in 2013, which resulted in a conviction. Records suggest that these four cases involved Horizon evidence, admissions by an accused, and a plea of guilty in circumstances where there was independent legal representation for the accused. They had not been drawn to the Crown's attention by the Post Office as cases of concern necessitating further examination. All four of these cases have been made known to the Commission, and I'm aware that one at least is currently under review. However, 11 cases have been identified in which prosecutors decided to suspend consideration of proceedings and thereafter take no further action. This was as a direct result of their concerns with the accuracy of the Horizon system and was consistent with the instruction to prosecutors to adopt a cautious approach. This limited the extent of the harm which the Horizon IT system may have otherwise caused. It has been suggested, with the benefit of hindsight, that the Crown should have been more suspicious of Post Office and should have conducted a review into convictions involving Horizon. However, the state of knowledge as it then was is not what we know it to be now. The Post Office, its lawyers and indeed UK government ministers continue to support the Horizon system during 2013 to 2015 and beyond. Some of the evidence before the ongoing Post Office inquiry suggests worrying levels of deliberate and sustained concealment and deception used by the Post Office during this period. Unfortunately, it was only after the English litigation in 2019 that the true nature, extent and depth of the problems with Horizon were revealed. Notwithstanding that, I am committed to reflecting on whether anything could have been done differently by Scottish prosecutors. In that regard, I await with interest the outcome of the UK Post Office IT inquiry and will continue to consider whether any lessons require to be learned. It is then important to remember that at the heart of this issue are individuals who were wrongly convicted of a crime they did not commit. Next week, Parliament will debate legislation designed to address this issue. The opportunity for debate is a development that I welcome, as the merits of the Scottish Government's bill can be considered and debated by you, the parliamentarians who are elected to do so. Thank you.
Thank you very much. The Lord Advocate will take questions on the issues arising from her statement. I intend to allow around 20 minutes, after which we will then move on to the next item of business. And I would encourage members who wish to ask a question, who haven't already done so, to press the request to speak buttons. And I call first Russell Finlay.
Thank you. I also thank the Lord Advocate for advance sight of her statement. Now, in January, she told Parliament, and I quote, "This miscarriage of justice is truly exceptional. Nothing similar has ever been seen before. Its facts and circumstances are unique, and I wholeheartedly agree, which is why my party has made repeated attempts for the head of Scotland's independent prosecution service to return here, and I'm therefore grateful that she has now decided to do so." In her statement, the Lord Advocate says that she has not previously opposed mass exoneration as this bill proposes. Now, that was the impression given by her previous statement in January. So I would like to ask her to use this opportunity to be clear whether or not she agrees with her Cabinet colleagues that mass exoneration is the right thing to do. My party does believe that it's the right thing to do. Now, it's also regrettable that the SNP has sought to turn this into yet another excuse to pick a constitutional fight with UK ministers. In their own words, the Scottish Government now recognises the need for standalone Scottish legislation. It's also regrettable that the Government now suggests that the passing of the Scottish Bill can only happen after the UK law has passed. I would urge the Scottish Government to have the confidence in this Parliament to commit to passing this legislation before summer. We have the power to do so, and I would ask the Lord Advocate if she agrees. Finally, I previously asked the Lord Advocate, former Lord Advocate Frank Mulholland, to come to Parliament, and I ask again, should her predecessor come to Parliament, and has she spoken with him about Horizon?
Lord Advocate.
So I think that I will begin by addressing the issue of the question of the legislation that's before the Parliament. The Government, of which I'm a member, has introduced a bill which reflects the Government's position. Like all ministers, I share that collective position. As I explained in my statement when I answered questions here in January, I addressed the proposition that I could use my authority to achieve a blanket exoneration through the courts, and I explained why it would not be possible for me to do that. Those comments have been taken out of context and held to show that I'm opposed to a legislative approach to addressing miscarriages of justice. As Lord Advocate, I exercised my retained functions, including decisions taken in my capacity as head of the systems of criminal prosecution and investigation of deaths in Scotland, independently of other ministers. In relation to legislation, my role as a law officer is to certify that government legislation is within the legislative competence of this Parliament, as it will be clear from the fact that the government has introduced a bill and I have provided that certification. In relation to Lord Mulholland, I have not discussed these matters with him, but from the material that's available to me and from my understanding as to what happened in the background to these matters, at no stage was Lord Mulholland involved in any matter to do with Horizon cases. In relation to the other matter, which relates to whether or not there was a question of my attendance to wishing to come here or not. I have made it endlessly clear that I am prepared to come to this Parliament to answer questions about the functions that I undertake. I take very seriously my accountability to the Scottish Parliament for the exercise of my functions as the head of the system of prosecution. My presence here today demonstrates that. I've been very candid about the actions of the Crown. I'm absolutely committed to transparency to ensure the public's confidence in the Scottish prosecution system is retained.
Thank you, Lord Advocate. We are going to have to move on. There is a lot of interest in this issue, as members will appreciate. So I think questions and responses will need to be as brief as they can. I call Polly McNeill.
Presiding Officer, I'd like to thank the Lord Advocate for coming to Parliament and for the full frank responses that she has given so far. It is clear from the current Post Office Horizon inquiry that senior post office officials came to Scotland in 2013 because they were concerned that Scottish procurator fiscals were rightly questioning the reliability of the Horizon system. And a recommendation by procurator fiscals at the time that all cases based on Horizon should be stopped. But after that meeting, the policy changed to a case-by-case basis. So I would like to know why Crown Office officials were satisfied to change the policy at the time when they had asked for further evidence to support the integrity of the Horizon system that they didn't yet have. Lord Advocate, may I thank you for your letter to me this week, and in it you note that regrettably there are four cases that have been identified that were prosecuted after that meeting in 2013, which resulted in convictions. And you note that on the basis of those admissions or pleas of guilt. But as we know, many sub-postmasters pled guilty to avoid jail. So I think we should have all the factors fully explained so that we can learn the lessons.
We need a question.
But more significantly, my question is this. After 2015, why did the Crown Office not apply their ongoing duty of disclosure to all those people who had been convicted with Horizon evidence? No cases were revisited and no conviction of postmasters were written to
thank
until
you,
well
McNeil.
After
thank
Alan
you, Ms.
Bates.
McNeil. Lord Advocate.
So in relation to the question posed, I have said before that the litigation in England and Wales in 2019 was a significant turning point, as with the decision of Hamilton in 2021. It was at that point that the true extent of the problems with Horizon were fully known. Up until that point, Post Office maintained its position and continued to defend the Horizon system. Work has been underway by the Crown in Scotland and the Scottish Criminal Case Review Commission for 4 years now. And since 2020, the Crown has worked with the Scottish Criminal Case Review Commission and other agencies to identify cases affected by what steps we can take to correct those injustices. So the passage of time is recognised, but the significant turning point, rather than it being 2015, was 2019, as is clear from the litigation and the reported cases that have been made available publicly since that time.
Thank you. Fergus Ewing, to be followed by Murdo Fraser.
Presiding Officer, obviously some crimes that may have been committed by sub-postmasters and mistresses, such as benefit fraud or cheques fraud, probably have nothing to do with Horizon whatsoever and should not be quashed. But may I ask the Lord Advocate a question that has been troubling me and I think others since her statement to this place in January, and that is this, that in that statement, she indicated that, in her view, not all Horizon cases involved miscarriages of justice. But where Horizon and the associated Fujitsu software were part of the chain of evidence that led to a conviction, then surely such evidence must be utterly tainted and discredited. And secondly, where those submasters pled guilty to such crimes, it has, I believe, been conclusively shown in the evidence to the Wynne Williams inquiry that some such confessions and guilty pleas were extracted by improper pressure exerted by the Post Office.
Lord Advocate.
Can she provide a full explanation of this, please?
Lord Advocate.
Yes. So, a very general definition of miscarriage of justice is a conviction wrongly returned against an innocent person. In some cases, it's been shown that Horizon identified shortfalls was a correctly identified shortfall. This was demonstrated by an admission of guilt, which included an explanation of why the funds were taken, what was done with them, and an independent verification of the use of those funds in the way described, with no suggestion or claim being made that the Horizon identified shortfall was inaccurate. In any such case, there can be no suggestion of a miscarriage of justice. In relation to those cases where there may be a miscarriage of justice, since I made my statement to Parliament in January, the Lord Justice Clerk Second, most senior judge in Scotland has issued an opinion of the appeal court on the 30th of April 2024 and advised that the court agreed with the Crown that the trial in any case, or the plea in any case, in which Horizon evidence was essential to conviction, whether as primary evidence or as essential corroboration, cannot be considered to have been fair and has resulted in a miscarriage of justice. So this is the approach the Crown was taking and continues to take. The point about guilty pleas is an important one, because the vast majority of these cases that are coming before the Court of Appeal and the ones that we have considered are cases in which the accused has pled guilty, there's been an admission of guilt, and the accused individual was independently legally represented at the time. A guilty plea in most circumstances is something of an issue that requires careful consideration and the input from the Court of Appeal in order to determine whether or not to quash a conviction. The circumstances of admissions of guilt and guilty pleas are ones that are carefully considered in the whole round when the concerns are looked at in relation to whether or not there has been a miscarriage of justice.
Thank you. Parliament will be aware that it allocated 30 minutes for this item of business. I'm prepared to exercise a degree of leeway, but there are further 11 members who wish to ask questions. We have now 9 minutes in which to get through that. I do want to get everybody that wants to ask a question in before we move on to the next item of business, but the questions will need to be briefer, as indeed will the responses, Lord Advocate. Murdo Fraser to be followed by Evelyn Tweed.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Lord Advocate said in her statement 11 cases have been identified in which prosecutors decided to suspend consideration of proceedings and take no action as a direct result of their concerns with the accuracy of the Horizon system. If no fewer than 11 individual fiscals were concerned about the accuracy of the Horizon system, why was this not ringing alarm bells at the top of the Crown Office and Procurator Fiscal Service? And why was the decision not taken at that point to cease all further prosecution proceedings?
Lord Advocate.
I have already explained that the issue as to the extent to which the Horizon system was identified as fundamentally flawed was not identified until 2019 and thereafter in 2020, when the decisions of the English Court of Appeal and the decision in the Bates case were returned. That was a starting point for which everybody became aware of the fundamental difficulties with the system itself. Prosecutors, when they became aware of the fact that there was bugs in the system that were reported on by the Second Sight report, looked at the report, asked the post office about it, were given absolute assurance that there was nothing wrong with the system, there was nothing wrong with any of the Scottish cases that had been prosecuted thus far, and there was therefore no basis upon which, after the decisions were taken not to prosecute the 11 cases, but to go forward with the four, for a full review to be done of all that had gone before. And this is consistent with the way in which the courts in England and Wales have approached the matter to date.
Thank you. Evelyn Tweed to be followed by Katie Clark.
It would appear from what we have heard during the public inquiry that people at the top of the post office have provided misleading information over the years in relation to the Horizon cases. Does the Lord Advocate share my concern in this regard? And what is her response to the evidence coming out of the public inquiry?
Lord Advocate.
I'm grateful for the question and, of course, share the concern. Post Office was a respected and trusted agency, and through its actions, many innocent people have suffered and had their lives ruined. Whilst the public inquiry is ongoing, and whilst appeal cases remain live in Scotland, I'm obviously limited in what I'm able to say. However, I am deeply troubled and concerned at the evidence which the inquiry has heard. The ongoing inquiry requires to fulfil its remit. I await with interest its outcome. In relation to any criminality in Scotland by any individuals within the Post Office, they will be considered through the normal process of reporting. And as you know, this issue affected the entirety of the United Kingdom, and I am committed to working closely with other agencies across the United Kingdom on that front.
Katie Clark, to be followed by Ruth Maguire.
I was an MP up until 2015 and a member of the Select Committee that took evidence in 2015. However, like many other MPs, I was aware of the very serious concerns being raised about the Horizon convictions prior to then. Does the Lord Advocate not accept that it was clear from at least 2013 that it was unsafe to prosecute these cases and indeed that any convictions were unreliable? Has the Lord Advocate given thought as to why the Crown Office wished to accept what the Post Office said and to prosecute so many people who had always been law-abiding when there was so much concern that there had been miscarriages of justice?
Lord Advocate.
I recognise the question that prosecutors could have done more earlier, and it's a proposition which relies on the benefit of hindsight. It is a professional responsibility of prosecutors to reflect upon how they have handled cases to help to ensure they do better in the future. The issues surrounding Horizon have now been the subject of detailed scrutiny within Crown Office, and nothing has presently been identified which shows that prosecutors should have dealt with matters differently. There is a public inquiry underway, and the Appeal Court in Scotland has cases under consideration. If there is anything identified in these processes which indicate that things could have been done differently, we will, of course, now pay great attention to that.
Thank you. I call Ruth Maguire to be followed by Maggie Chapman.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can the Lord Advocate expand further on the reasons the Crown Office and Procurator Fiscal Service decided to stop relying on Horizon-related evidence only from 2015, and what had been expected but not supplied by the Post Office at that time?
Lord Advocate.
Thank you. In 2013, the Crown Office was assured by Post Office that Scottish cases were not affected and Horizon continued to be robust. Notwithstanding these assurances, prosecutors requested that the Post Office provide further evidence to support what they were saying. Whilst prosecutors awaited those instructions being carried out, they adopted a cautious approach to these cases, which relied on Horizon evidence. In 2015, Post Office confirmed that it was not in a position to provide the evidence Crown Office had requested. On that basis, in the absence of independent evidence which demonstrated Horizon was in fact safe, a decision was made to no longer rely on Horizon evidence.
Thank you. Maggie Chapman, to be followed by Claire Adamson.
I thank the Lord Advocate for her statement. She speaks of convictions which have already been quashed by the High Court and also of two which are currently before the Court. What we don't know about are any cases in which convictions may have been upheld by the High Court or where the High Court refused to give leave to appeal. If such cases exist, they will be excluded from the bill as presently drafted. What assurances can the Lord Advocate provide that such cases that have already been considered by the High Court will have been given a fair hearing, given that more and more information is coming to light through various routes, including the public inquiry, which is still ongoing?
Lord Advocate.
There have been no appeals in relation to these cases refused by the Court of Appeal in Scotland. And for that reason, it's perhaps of some comfort to Ms. Chapman to hear that. Insofar as the ongoing process is concerned, the Court of Appeal is looking at these cases individually and with great care. And I think it should also be made clear to those here today that the Court of Appeal in Scotland are taking matters extremely seriously. For some time now, there has been a dedicated bench listening to these cases and having many procedural hearings and being advised of how matters are progressing. This dedicated bench has set down how it considers cases should be presented and argued and how it is, in certain circumstances, appeals should be granted. So there is some great comfort to be taken from the fact that there's been no appeals refused in Scotland and that we have a dedicated bench in Scotland looking at these matters. All of the appeals thus far taken have been granted by the Court on the basis of the Crown's concession. And in relation to the last two cases, it's quite clear that the same process will be delivered in relation to those two outstanding cases.
Thank you, Claire Adamson, to be followed by Alex Cole-Hamilton.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. I note in this statement that the Lord Advocate has said that the Criminal Equators Review Commission has been involved in identifying those who may have been wrongly convicted and letters have been sent out. Can I ask how many letters were issued, how many responses have been received, and if the Lord Advocate can envisage any other mechanism by which the courts can proactively reach out and encourage, rather than the onus being on the wronged parties who are very sceptical and very scared to come forward?
Lord Advocate.
I think this question was asked of me previously when I gave my first statement. And there is a distinction between the roles of the Crown Office and Prosecutor Fiscal Service and the Scottish Criminal Case Review Commission in these matters. They have very distinct roles to carry out. And insofar as numbers of letters that have been issued by the Commission and the uptake of those and the decisions that they've made to refer cases, I would ask that that question be referred to the Scottish Criminal Case Review Commission. My own understanding is that every single case that's been referred to the Commission has written out to the individual or their families. But for precise detail and to be absolutely accurate, this question should be directed to the Commission. And in relation to anything else that can be done in order to assist and encourage people to come forward, I simply restate what I said before. If you consider you're a victim of a miscarriage of justice in these matters, come forward, you will be supported, you will be given assistance, and you will be supported by the Scottish Criminal Case Review Commission. And we will do all we can to bring this matter forward to the courts, if it's the courts, or the matter will thereafter be dealt with by the legislation, if it's chosen to be passed by the democratically elected parliamentarians who sit here today.
Thank you. Alex Cole-Hamilton to be followed by Keith Brown.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm grateful for the clarity as to the role of this Parliament in making things right. We should move forward with haste. It's right that the Post Office has now been stripped of its status as a specialist reporting agency. It deceived everyone at every turn, laying down a smokescreen of lies long after they realised they were at fault. People paid for that with their livelihoods and, in some cases, their lives. Can the Lord Advocate advise as to what lessons have been learned and safeguards employed within those specialist reporting agencies that remain, and within the COPFS that receives their reports, to protect against similar unsafe prosecutions in the future?
Lord Advocate.
So the question is in relation to specialist reporting agencies and what can be done to ensure that they meet the legal framework within which they operate, which includes a duty of revelation and a duty of disclosure. These are obligations placed on the Crown of Scotland, and these are obligations that the specialist reporting agencies should understand that they need to take very seriously. There plainly was a complete abdication of the responsibility of the Post Office in the special status that they were given, which has resulted in the terrible consequences of these cases. So work has been ongoing in Crown Office to revisit the advice, support and direction given to specialist reporting agencies, and to tell them again about the law that they need to operate within, their duties of revelation and their duties of disclosure. So we have reflected, and we are not beyond reflection in looking at these issues. We are continue to revisit how it could be that there should be such a complete and utter abdication of the legal rules that apply to specialist reporting agencies as came about in this particular case.
Thank you. Keith Brown to be followed by Jamie Green.
The Lord Advocate has stated that the Post Office and the UK Government, in her words, continued to support the Horizon system during the 2013 to 2015 period and beyond, and that there was, again in her words, worrying levels of deliberate and sustained concealment and deception during this period. Is the Lord Advocate able to say whether this might present a liability for the Post Office and the UK Government, separate to any agreed compensation scheme? And given that the concealment was deliberate and sustained, and that it can reasonably be said to have led to the imprisonment, the traumatisation and even the suicide of some of the victims of this disgraceful deception, could this potentially result in criminal proceedings against those responsible for this deception?
Lord Advocate.
I'm not in a position to answer Mr Brown's question today. I think we really would need to await the outcome of the public inquiry, which has been ongoing for many years now, and we need to understand what the outcome would be of any particular investigation that the UK authorities are involved in looking at the moment. I've said it should be a UK-wide investigation, and these profound issues that concern us today are issues that concern everybody across the United Kingdom. So the specific points about criminal liability or civil liability, I'm just not in a position to answer today.
Jamie Green to be followed by Michael Mara.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Of course, the Post Office is guilty of the most egregious failures in this whole sorry saga. But let's not forget, it was the Crown in Scotland, who prosecuted people here. Given that, can I ask, particularly in the absence of Police Scotland's involvement in this, of any evidence gathering or assisting the Crown's prosecution, why the Crown took or sought no evidence contrary to that which was offered by the Post Office, and why technical evidence, which ultimately led to prosecutions, went unchallenged and was simply taken at face value, given the disastrous consequences of doing so?
Lord Advocate.
I think I've already explained that this Post Office Limited had been a specialist reporting agency in Scotland for a significant period of time, over many, many, many decades. It was a highly respected institution, and one in respect of which it was given UK-wide recognition. The Crown Office is not an investigating agency. The Crown Office relies on specialist reporting agencies to report cases in under a duty of disclosure and revelation. The Crown were entitled to take at face value the evidence submitted by Post Office and the assurances that were repeatedly given to the Crown as to the situation with Horizon evidence. I've said before that in 2013 that Crown Office were assured by the Post Office's legal team that included banisters and professional lawyers working with Post Office legal team that they had looked at all of the Scottish cases and there was no difficulty with any of them at all.
Thank you. Michael Mara to be followed by Craig Hoy.
I am glad that the Lord Advocate has begun to change her tune slightly on the position regarding specialist reporting agencies. On her last appearance in the Chamber on the 16th of January, she insisted that the Crown Office must be able to continue to trust without question the evidence of all such agencies above the citizens of Scotland, armed with readily available evidence as to the lack of reliability of those reporting agencies' evidence itself. So can Parliament have faith that a letter reminding other agencies of their duties is sufficient to prevent a repeat of the circumstances where the voice of the establishment automatically trumps the voice of the citizens?
Lord Advocate.
I did not say what Mr Mara said. I said I refute that completely. And I have repeatedly said this. I'm deeply troubled by what has occurred. I hope the statements that I've made give reassurance that prosecutors have never sought convictions in the knowledge that Horizon was unreliable. All prosecutors were acting in good faith on the basis of information supplied to them by the Post Office. I know innocent people have suffered, people were convicted when they should not have been, and people were forced to live for years with injustice. The responsibility for that lies with the Post Office and their repeated failures. But I have previously apologised as head of the system for prosecution of crime, which the Post Office is part of in Scotland, to the people who have suffered as a result of this scandal. And I continue to expect specialist reporting agencies who are given the confidence of that appointment by the Crown in Scotland to meet their legal obligations in relation to their duties of disclosure and revelation. And I think I've also explained earlier on today that we've revisited and reflected on the need to provide further direction and support for specialist reporting agencies and remind them of what the law requires them to do, if indeed they require to be reminded.
Thank you. And briefly, Craig Hoy.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Speaking in this chamber in January, the Lord Advocate said without qualification, and I quote, "Not every case involving Horizon evidence will be a miscarriage of justice, and each case must be considered carefully and with regard to the law." In what way can this very clear statement be taken out of context?
Lord Advocate.
Well, I think I did say that, and that is absolutely right. And what I was explaining was, as Lord Advocate with ministerial responsibility for the Crown Office and Prosecution Service, what it was that I could do in the context of the available mechanisms. I couldn't give a blanket exoneration through the mechanisms of law available, and I could only explain what it was that I could do in conjunction with the Scottish Criminal Case Review Commission and the Court of Appeal to remedy any miscarriage of justice. And that is what I explained. It's not, the explanation is completely right, it's not out of context, and I never at any point made any comment on the proposed legislative option that is now before this Parliament. It is, in fact, open to us to understand that you can deal with miscarriages of justice through our existing court system. That has been the view expressed by many eminent members of the legal profession, including the former Chief Justice of England and Wales in the recent debate in the House of Lords. But there are other options, such as legislation, and it's for the Government and Parliament to develop the policy to be implemented. The Lord Advocate does not offer a view on policy, nor have a vote. I am a law officer. It is not part of my function. It is for this Parliament of democratically elected members to choose between the available options, and that's what they're being asked to do.
Thank you, Lord Advocate. That concludes the statement. There will be a brief pause before we move to the next item of business to allow front benches to change.